Tunisia is located only a few kilometres away from Sicily. The Roman influence is therefore still very obvious. In 800 BC, the Punic Tunis was only a small village in the shadow of Carthage. Today, Tunis is a modern city with 1.2 million inhabitants. Wherever we look, the Tunisian flag is hoisted everywhere. The five columns of Islam, the state religion of Tunisia, are symbolized by a pentacle. The Muslims believe in God being the only one and Muhammad being his prophet. The teaching of Allah calls the faithful to pray, to fast, to give alms, and to make pilgrimage to Mecca. The Tunisian bazaars, the souks, tempt the tourist en masse to Medina, the oldest town in Tunisia, where the huge bazaars allure the visitors with traditional goods and African art. In the souk, one can buy water pipes, for example. Another way to enjoy tobacco is in the numerous cafes, where Tunisian men like to meet and chat while smoking a water pipe. One finds Tunisian originality in the winding streets of the souk. Most of the goods at the bazaar are made on the spot. The visitor can watch this process and even express his or her own wishes. The Tunisians win their customers over thanks to their friendly approach, whilst making shopping even more comfortable with the Arabic equivalent to beverage home delivery. The traditional headgear in Tunisia is the so-called chechia, which is handmade in the souk. The hat maker Abd el Qadar al Youi is famous for his craft. He receives fan mail from the whole world and he can tell us a lot about the origin and development of Arabic headgear. This one is being bought only by women. They wear it at weddings and other festive occasions. This hat is therefore decorated and embroidered with pearls. The others here are destined for other countries. This one is, for example, worn in Morocco or Turkey. Here, people wear a dark red chechia, just like the one I have on. It is a tradition in Tunisia. Actually, the chechias originate from Spain. In the 8th century, they came on the trade route from Spain to Maghreb. To get more acquainted with the history of the land, one shouldn't fail to visit the Bardo Museum. There is a world-famous archaeological collection placed in the rooms of the Bey Palace that was built in 1859. Mainly Roman mosaics created in the time between the 2nd century BC and the 7th century AD are exhibited here. Amongst the oldest exhibits are these 2,700-year-old Punic tombstones. Tunisia possesses the world's largest mosaics collection. The Romans occupied Tunisia in those days and they brought their riches from beyond the Mediterranean Sea to a safe place. These mosaics come from a variety of places in Tunisia. Altogether, there were 240 excavated in nearly complete condition. Here we can see, for example, the famous mosaic of Odysseus on his Odyssey near the Sirens Island. Proudly related in the history of Tunisia, Homer's hero might have met these seeing creatures off the Tunisian coast. One of the most valuable mosaics in the world depicts Virgil between the Muses. On his knees, the poet holds a papyrus roll with the 8th verse of his work Aeneas. This mosaic is stored in the beautifully decorated harem's quarter of the Bey Palace. Mens sana in corpore sano. A healthy spirit lives in a healthy body. This at least was taught by the old Romans. After a cultural trip, one should relax a bit and mix with the people. They meet at a late hour in the streets to enjoy crepes and other specialities. But when night comes to Tunis, most of the tourists disappear into their buses and return back to their holiday resorts on the Mediterranean. Hardly any strangers are left in the capital. Not many tourists visit this land just because of Tunis, even though the city can offer a lot. A few kilometres away from Tunis is Sidi Bou Said. This rocky village was closed to non-Muslims until 1819. Fortunately, this rule is not in place anymore, since each detail here is a work of art, and the view over the harbour and the Gulf of Tunis is truly picturesque. On their Tunisian journey of 1914, the three painters Malalouis Mwallier, Paul Klee and August Mackin painted this very panorama. Shortly before his death, August Mackin had depicted the Café de Nate in his picture, A Look at a Mosque. Today this cafe is a meeting place for people to sing, drink mint tea and relax together. It is recommended one continues the trip to another harbour town that is located about 150 kilometres southwards from Tunis, Port El Kantaoui. This town was built in 1970 only, in Andalusian style, to attract tourists and well-off Tunisians. The charm of the so-called Tunisian Saint-Tropez is nearly impossible to escape from. The centre is simply attractive, and it oozes with a Mediterranean holiday atmosphere. The harbour, though, is traditionally Arabic, but has naturally adapted to foreign guests as well. Travellers have many opportunities to put to sea here. At first, one can watch tiny fish from a small yellow submarine, whilst divers can observe impressive objects very closely below. The journey continues further southwards past olive trees into the surroundings of Monastir. For those keen on golf, the Flamingo Monastir golf course with an area of 110 hectares is a must. Located on a plateau, one can view the whole landscape up to the sea during the game. To get more acquainted with the history of the land, one shouldn't fail to visit the Bardo Museum. There is a world-famous archaeological collection placed in the rooms of the Bay Palace that was built in 1859. Mainly Roman mosaics created in the time between the 2nd century BC and the 7th century AD are exhibited here. Amongst the oldest exhibits are these 2,700-year-old Punic tombstones. Tunisia possesses the world's largest mosaics collection. The Romans occupied Tunisia in those days, and they brought their riches from beyond the Mediterranean Sea to a safe place. These mosaics come from a variety of places in Tunisia. Altogether, there were 240 excavated in nearly complete condition. which is handmade in the souk. The hat maker Abd el Qadar al-Yuri is famous for his craft. He receives fan mail from the whole world, and he can tell us a lot about the origin and development of Arabic headgear. This one is being bought only by women. They wear it at weddings and other festive occasions. This hat is therefore decorated and embroidered with pearls. The others here are destined for other countries. This one is, for example, worn in Morocco or Turkey. Here, people wear a dark red chechia, just like the one I have on. It is a tradition in Tunisia. Actually, the chechias originate from Spain. In the 8th century, they came on the trade route from Spain to Maghreb, down in Tunisia, where the huge bazaars allure the visitors with traditional goods and African art. In the souk, one can buy water pipes, for example. Another way to enjoy tobacco is in the numerous cafes, where Tunisian men like to meet and chat while smoking a water pipe. One finds Tunisian originality in the winding streets of the souk. Most of the goods at the bazaar are made on the spot. The visitor can watch this process and even express his or her own wishes. The Tunisians win their customers over thanks to their friendly approach, whilst making shopping even more comfortable with the Arabic equivalent to beverage home delivery. The traditional headgear in Tunisia is the so-called chechia. Tunisia is located only a few kilometers away from Sicily. The Roman influence is therefore still very obvious. In 800 BC, the Punic Tunis was only a small village in the shadow of Carthage. Today, Tunis is a modern city with 1.2 million inhabitants. Wherever we look, the Tunisian flag is hoisted everywhere. The five columns of Islam, the state religion of Tunisia, are symbolized by a pentacle. The Muslims believe in God being the only one and Muhammad being his prophet. The teaching of Allah calls the faithful to pray, to fast, to give alms, and to make pilgrimage to Mecca. The Tunisian bazaars, the souks, tempt the tourist en masse to Medina, the oldest